So, hello everyone. Since this is my first video, I'll take a minute or two to just quickly introduce who I am so people know why I'm talking about this. So, my name is Till. I'm mostly known on the internet as Toasty or Toasterson or, the real toast or one of the other brands I have. I have a little bit of an opinion on the supply chain things, mostly because I'm active in this from the Lumos side. And besides the ARM thing, I've also studied into this whole supply chain thing a bit, because it's something that just is a bit natural to working with open source and really figuring out how this kind of thing works. And there's a lot of changes there happening at the moment. And since this is hopefully not becoming a hype soon-ish, I wanted to take a couple minutes to talk about it from my view and my experience, since there needs to be some setup for people to look into and as well know what this is actually about and what people are talking about. So, as how I am involved, I am involved as a maintainer of a distribution of OpenIndiana, namely. And this is a distribution of Illumos, aka Open Solaris in the old days, and which is a descendant of Sun Solaris. So the old venerable operating system, which is kept up to date by people, is published as source code. So for people that cannot build this, you kind of are reliant to get that you can download something that gets you started. Like, you need something that can execute on your computer so you can just install it. And that's where this, in Illumos land, the distributions come in. So OpenIndiana has been the first one and always has been the kind of like sponsored upstream one. Although there have been upstarts and like changes in the community and people not liking each other and like trying to figure out which direction it should go, should it have releases or not, should it, which model to go, so forth. Like, there's been a ton of arguments around this. There's always like a demand side, and there's also like a supply side, and you try to organize a group of people, of suppliers, that have probably very different requirements. So if you do consortium like this, there is a couple of things you just have to say, look, this is what we do, and the other things you have to do yourself. Otherwise, you have to invest into it as a group, as a sub-consortium, as an interest group. If you want releases, you have to put money somewhere to make an interest group releases, because otherwise you're just externalizing costs. And yeah, that's kind of like the main point here. So recently this has also more come up with the Rust ecosystem, which I'm also part of, but more as like a developer, because I use it and I want to get things done. But if you want to get things done on a systems programming level, you have to have a couple of resources. You need to be able to output to the terminal to make web connections to interact with services and do that in reasonable manner without writing 10,000 times http.get somewhere. And yeah, the thing has become this discussion between how to look at a supply chain has been long. So we had the first initial discussions around how the model should work, because back then a supplier died. Some microsystems was a supplier. So in a supply chain, you have a supplier and you satisfy a demand. You make money with that. Some microsystems did that and they got undercut by hype and other situations, but also with the free software movement, which tries to see, especially code, as knowledge. So people can learn more freely, can be autodidactic, and don't have to go to a like huge place with 10,000 licenses, sign 10,000 NDAs and so on, which is understandable and brings in a good point, but you're trying to get that in. But some businesses really get predatory in this way. So they see like, oh, there is free stuff I can take. And with that stuff, I can undercut a competitor. And that's basically what happened. We have now very, very cheaply produced hardware and software that is just there for the push it out and never think about it. Oh, we can't do any innovation. And people think like, how can't you not do any innovation? You have 10,000 problems to solve. Yeah, you have 10,000 problems to solve, but you cannot invest because you undercut so much, there is no margin for investment. And that's become kind of like the main problem in the PC market. So it eventually died and people were like, yeah, we can only sell our cloud services because we can sell our resources we're not using, Amazon. And that became like a whole hype and, oh, finally something is happening again. And yeah, finally something is happening. Now they're basically asking for a premium because they're like, yeah, we have all our supply chain in-house. They have a complete supply chain for hardware, software, patches, everything in-house. They use open technologies like KVM and Linux as a basis. Like the free software movement intended, yes, this is knowledge, you can use it, you can modify it. But they have a complete software supply chain in-house. They're a giant. Same as with Microsoft and with Google. These are giants. They are countries within themselves. They are supply chains within themselves. They are value chains within themselves. And at the end of the day, the only reason these companies survive is as zombies, because you have a part of the supply chain that is now locked into this one supplier, this one thing. And this seems so, like, economically, like pure business economically, this is the worst thing to be for, especially at a certain scale, because now you cannot sell things that you can produce over demand out. Say you're producing computers in an internal supply chain. Okay, cool. That's one way to get started. And one way you can solve yourself a problem if no producer gets there. Vertical integration can help a lot in this kind of deals. And we see this a lot with how every company that just takes off has vertical integration. But that's also only possible because they have a virtual insurmountable input of money. And that comes from not just sales, it comes from them being able to define their own margins for their product. Apple, for example, has their fixed computers as a product. And they have the whole supply chain behind it, and they have their own supply chain issues, they have their own things, they have their own place. And if you really make this with the lowest cost possible, you can gain a lot of margin out of it. But if you then start to make it exclusive, you start to cut off that supply chain from any other money input they could make. Say, Apple's chip exclusivity is a good one in that regard, because they are starting to get more, hey, get this chip to me exclusively. Now that chip isn't available for anybody else. This allows for monopolization, but again, that's actually technically illegal. That's not what where we want to go. And at some point, there will either come the hammer or the more realization that, hey, this is not the point. It gives us a lot of freedom to do stuff. But again, we only don't have the freedom because people are just stupid. People are more concerned about non-tech things in a tech company and basically trying to sell each other's product and like keep like a setup going, or like, oh, you have Microsoft Windows, yeah, everything's compatible, nothing changes, you still need an antivirus to get something changed. It's like, yeah, you don't need that. If you modify and learn from your problems, you can fix that. But if the way we're going about it, we're going to just have internal supply chains within companies. And sometimes, like cloud in Amazon, like AWS, that was basically AWS being like, hey, we're making a cloud for ourselves, we could sell it. And then they gain massive money out of it because they have a good base product for internally dog fooded. And be like, hey, we sold that externally and wow, it works. Yes, of course it works. You've done a good product internally, you can also sell it externally. That's how you can expand from a single product business with a large integrated supply chain to a multi-product business with a supply chain as a backbone. That's how you gain a lot more of money, because all of a sudden, not just the end of the value chain is your customers. All through the value chain, all through the supply chain, you have products to sell. Sometimes you may need to put more investment and effort into it to make it worthwhile. Like Amazon is not going to end up as a PC computer company all of a sudden. Or it's not going to produce laptops right now. They don't have the investment and setup, but they can slowly diverge into it and start integrating other products. Of course, that's the point where you get to antitrust and be like, yeah, that's like, why is this a closed supply chain? Why does all the products have to be there? Why can't I use Apple products and Amazon together? Because otherwise you're creating parallel economies, and that's not good. So that's what the supply chain is. And with the other side, we have the programmers that do this as a hobby that ended up with a completely different supply chain that frankly shouldn't exist, to be honest. If you make a program, you publish it, you solve yourself an itch to output to the terminal with the right codes, and you research the codes, you update the specs and make it easy usable, then that's a software done. And if somebody actually has to fix it for some reason in their code or uses it, they have to be aware that it is there and to be able to fix it. So gigantic dependency trees are quite a hassle in this regard. And we had the situation with Java coming up, we had the situation with JavaScript coming up, NPM, and there's a couple of lessons to be learned out of that, where if you really make a program and include 10,000 libraries in 10,000 different versions, you're gonna have a problem. And no matter what, if a sublibrary then includes it in a different version and it's not compatible anymore, this just ends up blowing up everything. This is like the worst thing to handle, is this dynamic chain of dependencies that just grows because people just are using it. It's like, oh, this is as fast as I can. Because it is the fastest way you can get something done. And if you optimize your business process to use the fastest way to get something done, you're gonna end up with a lot of cost output. And now we start companies saying like, oh, we've done this now. Now that we don't change it, we are gonna solve it by just pinging every developer and asking for the software distribution agreements and stuff. And it's like, you're doing the exact opposite of what people want. You're using hobby work in a professional setting without money changing hands, without doing this proper supply chain setup like Amazon and the others did to make your costs go away. Okay, so the only way that this will make reasonably economic sense is if there's a supplier saying, we look at this specific chain of dependencies and we are fixing it for you for a fee, monthly fee. A monthly, you have liquidity to pay, so even if you end up paying a royal amount of money, you can plan it in. Number two is you can decouple the price for this action from the final situation, so that makes sense. But people basically be like, oh, we are software developers who need to solve this. No, you're not software developers that need to solve this. You need to be a business person to solve it. This is a business problem. This is not a software problem. This is a societal problem. This is a problem of business doesn't know what the hell software does. This is a problem of, hey, a business manager has no fucking clue of what the dependency chain is. And that's a problem. And I shouldn't have to never go through that. Well, let's see if you do better. Anyway, to conclude, what we see a lot in DevOps and in like this DevOps utopia dreams where we want to go to is you have a chain from source code to compiling it to getting the compiled output as a package to then integrate it into the system and execution environment you want to put it. And with that execution environment, you deploy that. That's a whole set of steps you do. And that's a supply chain. That's a supply chain. That's a thing people do. And that's a internal operating cost or an internal thing that can, with products, be unified and made better. Not just with, oh, we offer a repository. Oh, we offer it. You can save your packages on GitHub, your Docker images on GitHub. No, this is more like the GitLab approach where you say, oh, we do a complete integrated setup, but don't take the hype approach and put Kubernetes in it, but really go in there and say like, hey, this is the process of the supply chain. This is what people are doing. So let's see what types of, at what stages in that process we can offer people services and get something out of it. There is companies that do that. There is companies like JFrog. There is, JFrog? Artifactory? There's so many companies doing that. Especially in different ecosystems. It's like Java is like a big ecosystem for that, because that's the current professional setup and you need to have things under control. But a lot of these newer ecosystems rely fully on an internet-based public setup, which gets you problems because you do not know if that developer behind that library that you're absolutely dependent on and cannot change actually will do something for you. And that's where I go now with Illumos on ARM and Illumos and OpenIndiana as a distribution, where I say, look, I'm a maintainer of this distribution. I can offer you trainings, content, go through with you through the details. I can show off all the things. I can make all the organization possible. I know the people. I'm the guy to talk to if you want to get into Illumos and want to do that professionally. But it's gonna cost you. Because A, I need to pay rent, and eventually if too many people ask, I will need to hire people. That is a cost. They need to pay rent. And that means there needs to be money exchanging hands. It's not more or like millions of dollars that we're talking about. It's normal salaries, salary range. Because you need to have at least a certain amount of people, or at least a certain amount of personal hours invested into every chain that you build. So you have to invest with every customer that they get their updates, that all the source code is checked through, even if they are closer to upstream or what is publicly available, the better. If you can make that stuff upstream, the better. But you also have to make sure that certain things don't end up upstream. We have seen the upstreaming hell with Red Hat and its products, where some customers just use the product for certain things and Red Hat just sells it and just does it and adds a feature for it. And it's like, yeah, that one customer uses it and now it's a maintenance burden. Great. To be honest, these kinds of things you have to be also very careful about. You cannot always do it. At some point, it's a change within the customer that needs it, or it's like a specific repository. And you have to build up your supply chain for that. And that's not something you can price over licenses for servers, and then maybe you have enough money or maybe not. That's something you need to directly price with somebody and say, look, you want ARM Illumos, and you want it going, we need to be on a mission for it. This mission is gonna cost you this. And then we go do it, and we have liabilities and the contract to really have that settled and to get going. That's how proper business works. That's how you do a supply chain. A real business, a real deal, a real place to, not physical place, but like a real business transaction. That's the supply chain. Everything else is not a supply chain. Cargo vet is not a supply chain. Public repositories are not a supply chain. Public Docker images are not a supply chain. And using those Docker images, building from source, that's an internal supply chain. Okay. I think I've rambled long enough. Yeah, let's see what people think. And leave something in the comments. Reach to me out on Twitter at TheRealToaster. Send me on socials, you find me. I'll try to put it in the comments. And that's it. I hope you enjoyed the information and like this content, and let me know if you want to hear more or what you want to hear more of. And yeah, let's get this channel started a bit. I will need to push some content, educational stuff anyway, first for myself, but also for other people, and yeah, that's also supply chain. I'm a supplier of information to get started with Illumos. So enjoy. Bye-bye.